church, come on. Let's read together Galatians 5, verses 13 and 14. For you were called to freedom, brothers. Only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh. For the whole law is fulfilled in one word. You shall love your neighbor as yourself.
Unto thee, O Lord, do I lift up my soul. Unto thee, O Lord, do I lift up my soul. O my God, I trust in thee. Let me not be ashamed, let not my enemies triumph over me.
Yea, let none that way on me be ashamed. Yea, let none that way on me be ashamed. Oh my God, I trust in thee. Let me not be ashamed, let not mine enemies triumph.
Morning. This is a beautiful day. This week, not only do we celebrate, as we do every Sunday, the freedoms that we have in Christ, we also remember the freedoms we have in this country to worship and to glorify our Lord. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, thank you. Thank you for allowing us to be your children. Thank you for this country that we live in that allows us to worship your holy name. And Father, we thank you that this morning we are here today. In this place that many call your house, but it's where your family gathers here to glorify you. Father, as we share, as we encourage, as we praise you, as we listen to your word, may all that we do this morning glorify no one and nothing else but you, for you are our Lord, our King. Father, we thank you in your Son's holy and precious name. Amen. Again, welcome. Glad to have you join us here this morning as we gather in the Lord's name to glorify him on this first Sunday of June. Couple of quick announcements that we have this morning. Our Bible study, which meets on Wednesdays at 7 p.m., will not be meeting this week because of complications. It's because the pastor is going to be out of town this week. Those that attend decided this last Wednesday to not meet this week to make things easier. Our men's group, by the way, which meets at Tuesdays at 9:30 a.m., will be meeting. But for those that join us online via Zoom, the Zoom will not be available. So keep that in mind. Next week, At 5:30 p.m. before our evening worship service is our ministry meetings, the first one of our fiscal year. Love to have you join us and be part of one of our ministry meetings that meets here at, it'll be next week at, this evening. It meets, our ministry meetings meets this evening at 5:30 p.m. Music camp for kids program is going to be starting up in a couple of weeks on July 17th. They'll be meeting Monday through Friday from 3 to 5 p.m. and then have special rehearsals, which Bonnie will let the kids know on those on Saturday, and then a program for us on that Sunday, the 23rd. Pastor Ed is going to be on vacation this week, so love to have you guys keep Lynn and I and my sister in prayer as we travel. Thank you for the opportunity to be able to go. Rahelia will be available to deal with anything that does come up this week. Next week is when Ian Carlisle, the chaplain of the Ambassadors of Reconciliation Ministries, will be here sharing about the prison ministry for Butte County. And also, of course, following that will be a potluck after church. And this evening, we are having our evening service at 6:30 p.m. as we look at the Forgotten God with Francis Chan. And this week, we will be talking about a real relationship. We do have a couple of birthdays this week. One birthday. On Saturday is Jeanette Jimenez's birthday. And so we want to wish you a happy birthday. And also on Friday is Lynn and I's anniversary. Jeanette, here's a song that we want to share with you to celebrate your birthday.
It's your birthday and we celebrate the day you were born, the light that God gave. Yeah, it's your birthday and we are all here thanking the Lord for giving you one more year. Blow out your candles and say a prayer. As for God's plan, our wishes never compare. The next 365 days, may you daily open the gift of God's grace.
I'm satisfied with just a cottage below, a little silver and a little gold. But in that city where the ransom will shine, I wanna go on that silver. Just over the hilltop, in that bright land where we'll never grow old. And someday yonder, we'll never more wander, but walk the streets that are pure as gold. Over the hillside, in that bright land where we'll never
pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our sins. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. And by his wounds we are healed.
He was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our sins. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. And by his wounds we are healed. We are healed by your sacrifice, in the life that you gave. We are healed, for you paid the price. By your grace we are saved, we
Have you ever heard someone say that there are many ways to heaven and that the Christians are just too narrow-minded to think that Jesus is the only way? God's word, though, is unambiguous and unequivocal about this topic. In John 14:6, Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." And in Acts 4:12, Peter says, "Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved." Maybe those of us who follow Christ are narrow-minded when it comes to our faith in Jesus Christ. We believe that Jesus' words are true. Wide is the gate and broad is the road that leads to destruction. And many enter through it. But small is the gate, and narrow the road that leads to life, and only a few found it. Those words Jesus shares during his Sermon on the Mount in Matthew chapter 7. Immediately after he shares these words, immediately after teaching that God gives good gifts to those who ask him. What could be a greater gift than salvation? And his narrow road discussion was followed by a warning to watch out for false prophets in verse 15. It is vital for our faith to trust God's word, especially on such life and death issues. Why would God, the creator and master over everything, provide multiple ways to come to him? Why would he need to create many options? He didn't. God designed one way, a beautiful way, to bring us back into relationship with him. Jesus is the way. Peter didn't say a particular congregation, denomination, or movement would save you. And Jesus didn't say ritual, tradition, practice, or work will save you. No. Jesus is the only way. Jesus plus anything else is unnecessary and dangerous. When we add other things, we can too easily become dependent on them to save us. And we can too easily worship them in place of God. Jesus' sacrificial death for you and me was enough. As we take the bread that represents Jesus' body and drink the cup that represents his shed blood, we pause to remember that Jesus is the way, the only way to our Father, to God. Salvation is found in no one else. He is enough. Let's pray. Lord Father, as we come to this time in our together this morning, we shift our thoughts to the gift of your Son, who you allowed to go to the cross to pay for the penalty that we could not pay. And Father, we are rest assured that he is enough. What he did on the cross, and through him and him alone, we have been given access to you. That we can come before you and you give us, through our faith in your Son, eternal life and forgiveness of our sins. Father, we remember that this morning as we take of the cup and as we take of the bread. And we proclaim together your great love. Father, ask your blessings on those who partake this morning. For your Son's holy and precious name we pray. Amen. Will you repeat with me the good confession? I believe with all my heart that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. I think the face of the little girl on the screen says it all. Giving to God is not a burden. The giving of tithes and offerings is not a struggle, but a blessing. And that's what we do each week. Let's pray. Father God, we take time this morning to take from the blessings you've given us and give back to you. Father, I ask that you receive our tithes and our offerings. And we pray that they are used to glorify you, to spread the message of your love to this world, and to allow this congregation to continue ministering in your name in this community. Father, we thank you and we praise you in your Son's holy and precious name. Amen. think one of the joys that we have on Sunday mornings is the opportunity to share with each other praises that we have and prayer needs that we have. And this last week, I just want to share some praises that came in. Some praises as Marilena is home from the hospital. Some of you know that Marilena spent a couple of days. She had some problems, some blockage in her arteries. They took a look. They didn't need to do any surgery or anything like that. They didn't need to do an angioplasty, but they did give her some medication to help her in dealing with that. And we continue praising. Sharon Lofmiller had some rough days last week, but she is doing much better. So we praise the Lord for that. And Sharon shared that her friend Fran is doing better, but she's still in the nursing facility. So we want to keep praying for her. And also continuing our prayers, the prayers that we have before us is music camp. It's coming up in just a couple of weeks, the opportunity for this church to minister to our community and to some young people. And we want to lift up Bonnie and those that are helping out and the kids that will be coming for that. Sally Eaton would like us to pray for some friends of her, several friends that she has who really need the Lord, that she's been sharing and loving on and talking about God's love with them. And also, I want to ask that you pray for Lynn and myself and my sister Patty as we travel tomorrow, Monday, to Utah to visit my aunt and uncle, who, by the way, join us online. And so we are looking forward to seeing you guys in just a day or so. Also, we want to continue praying for our church, that we continue to become the church that God needs us to be right here where he has placed us. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we thank you and we praise you for this opportunity that you've given us, access to your throne room to bring before you those things that are on our heart. Father, we thank you that Marilyn is doing better and that she's home from the hospital. We thank you that Sharon and Fran are doing better. Continue being with Fran as she is being taken care of at the nursing facility. May those that are taking care of her really help her to get back into her strength that she needs. And Father, we lift up our music camp and Bonnie and the staff that's working with her for that and the kids and families that are involved. We pray that lives will be changed and the message of your love will be seen. Father, be with Sally as she meets and talks and shares with friends who need to know you. Allow the love that you've poured into her be seen by others so they can understand what a relationship with you truly means. Father, I thank you for being with Lynn and I and my sister Patty as we travel to Utah this week. Keep us safe on the roads as we go there and back, and may our time with my Aunt Carrie and Uncle Larry be a time of encouragement for them. And Father, I lift up this congregation that loves you so much. Father, help us in our journey to become more and more like what you want us to be so that the message of your love can be seen by those who need to see it and hear it. And Father, be with me this morning as I share from your word. Allow your words to shine so that you may receive all glory, honor, and praise. Father, this we pray in your Son's holy and precious name. Amen. Our scripture reading for this morning is found in Romans chapter 5, verses 1 through 5. Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him we have also obtained access by faith into this grace which we stand. We rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that our sufferings produce endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. Many years ago, a major American magazine published the results of a most fascinating survey. The editors asked 16 prominent Americans what they did in order to find peace of mind in the middle of our stressful world. Their responses were quite revealing. Noted author James Michener reported that he found peace of mind by walking his two dogs along a deserted country road, old streams, and fields that have not been plowed for half a century. Barry Goldwater, former senior senator from Arizona, said that he found peace of mind in his hobbies, boating, photography, and flying. He especially found peace of mind by taking reflective walks in the Grand Canyon. Walter Cronkite, the former CBS anchorman, said he preferred solitude, usually by going to sea in a small boat. Sammy Davis Jr., he listed looking for the best in others as a way to find peace of mind. And Bill Moyers, the celebrated producer of many PBS documentaries, he found peace of mind by attending family reunions, preferably those held in out-of-the-way places. When you consider these responses, several observations come to mind. They are essentially subjective and dependent on outward circumstances. They reflect a desire for an ideal world, a quiet place to think, a place to be alone, or with people you can trust. Who among us can identify with such longings? In this fast-paced world where conflict and division seem to be so prevalent, we would all like to find that old stream or deserted road or those forgotten towns where we can stroll down the street unnoticed. The responses also show that there is a universal desire for peace of mind. One other interesting thing is that none of the answers relates peace of mind to worldly goals, such as money, fame, success, or power. And yet those are often the very things that are sought after the most in life. So often people spend their lives seeking money, sex, and power, hoping that they find satisfaction there. But money rarely brings satisfaction. Ask anyone with money if their money makes them happy. Their answer most often will be no. The same is true for power. Many who have power just want more. To move up the ladder to seek a higher office. Are they satisfied? No. They usually have their sights on the next rung in the ladder, their next position. And what about sex? Does that satisfy? Ask the broken victims of this generation about sex. Lonely women, frustrated men, aimlessly coupling and uncoupling, searching through the night. For what? We have unlimited sexual freedom, but we don't have peace of mind or anything like it. So what's left? If money, sex, and power doesn't satisfy, what will? I think the answer must be that the satisfaction that we seek, the peace of mind that we crave, the sense of fulfillment we so desperately want, is simply not found in this world. Nothing in this world satisfies the hunger within. The answer has to come from outside the world. Satisfaction, peace of mind, comes from God and from nowhere else. I think that's what Augustine was trying to say 1,500 years ago when he wrote his famous prayer, "You have made us yourself, and our hearts are restless until they find their rest in you." Pascal said something similar when he commented that there's a God-shaped vacuum or hole inside each man. We try to fill that vacuum with things of this world, money, sex, power, prestige, but the results is spiritual indigestion. Our tummies are full, but our hearts are empty. Where can we go to find the things we want more than anything else in this world? Where we can go? To God. For in Him is what we find, what we seek. With that in mind, let's look again at Paul's letter to the Christians in Rome. We've been in the sermon series called Pursuing Righteousness from God based on Paul's letter. We've been looking at this impactful letter for a few months, and last week we finally finished up chapter 4. In those four chapters, Paul's focus has been on the power of the gospel to put people who are locked up in sin and under sentence of God's wrath into a right relationship with God. Through the preaching of the good news, the gospel, God invites all people, Jews and Gentiles alike, to believe in Christ and enter into this new relationship of salvation by grace through faith. Paul's entire description of the gospel can be summed up in just one word: justification. Justification means to declare righteous. It comes from the courtroom and pictures the moment when a verdict of not guilty is declared by the judge. Robert Mouse offers this excellent summary of justification. To be justified means to be acquitted, to gain a right standing. Justification frees the guilty man from paying the just penalty of his sins. It declares that he is totally exonerated. All charges are dropped. Justification is the act where God declares a sinner righteous. It declares that he is totally exonerated, that all charges are dropped. It's where he declares us not guilty. The moment he or she expresses their faith and repentance when one's baptized into Jesus. This acquittal is absolutely free because it is based on the unfettered favor of the grace of God. God arranged a plan by which he could justify the guilty and still remain a moral being. And then he carried it out. It's a free offer. The only option we have is to accept it or reject it. Justification means that God has done everything necessary for us to go to heaven. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, paid the price for our sin. There is nothing you or I can do in the least bit to add to our salvation. So, as Paul begins the fifth chapter of Romans, he turns his attention to what comes after one's justification. In chapters 5 through 8, Paul focuses on two matters in particular. The first matter is our certainty that our justification will lead to final salvation. The second is the new power God gives us in our continuing struggle against sin and the law. The assurance of our salvation dominates the beginning of chapter 5 and the end of chapter 8, kind of like bookends framing the arguments that he puts forth. And then in the middle of chapter 6 and 7, Paul deals with the two continuing threats to our assurance: sin and the law. Now that you have a small picture where Paul is taking us, let's focus our attention on these first five verses of Romans chapter 5 that I read a few minutes ago. Let's rejoice and marvel at the beginnings, that the blessings, that are ours because of our justification in Christ. That justification by faith is a universal experience of all who put their faith in Jesus. In Paul's mind, there is no such thing as an unjustified Christian. If you're not justified by faith in Christ, then you aren't a Christian at all. The only way to be right with God is to put your trust in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Nothing, absolutely nothing else can give us a right standing with God. In these first verses of Romans 5, Paul reveals three great blessings that come to the believer as a result of our justification by faith. The first great blessing is found in verse 1. Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. The first blessing from our justification is we have peace with God through Jesus. The word peace means to be in a state of well-being and prosperity because the war has ended. Now, some here might remember VE Day or VJ Day at the end of World War II. Most of us can remember the celebration at the end of the Persian Gulf War in 1991. And many of us look forward to hearing the end of the conflict, the war in Ukraine. Peace means that fighting is over and that the soldiers have put down their guns. But more than that, peace means that the restoration means that the restoration of a broken relationship has occurred. It is more than just the end of fighting and bickering. It's what happens when people who haven't been speaking once again become friends. Peace is a positive change in relationship between two people who were once enemies. In the beginning, Adam and Eve lived in peace with God. Then sin entered the relationship and humans turned to their own devices. And the relationship with God was broken. The Bible tells us that our sin causes every person to become an enemy of God. But now Paul tells us that through Jesus, and as a result of our justification, we can have peace with God. Peace with God and the peace of God. Please don't confuse peace with God with the peace of God. Peace with God and the peace of God are two different things. The peace of God, it's the sense of moment-by-moment happiness that we may have as we trust God, our Heavenly Father, in the midst of problems, of the problems of life. But peace with God comes as a result of accepting Christ's sacrifice for salvation. It means that God's wrath is no longer hanging over us. Heaven and justice is satisfied. We are no longer enemies of God, but through Christ we have become friends. Both are vitally important, but peace with God comes before the peace of God. Some people ask the question, have you made your peace with God? Did you know that the Bible never uses that expression? Because it is impossible for us to make peace with God. Humans, that's you and I, can't do that. We can't make peace with the Almighty, the Creator of the universe. It starts with God. In Colossians 1:20, we are told that Jesus made peace by the blood of His cross. If Jesus made peace when He died on the cross, then all that is left for us to do is to accept by faith the peace that He already made. So we don't make peace with God. He made peace with us through Jesus' crucifixion on the cross of Calvary. Peace with God is the first blessing that comes to the Christian as a result of justification. The second great blessing is that we have access to God and God's grace. We see that in the very first part of verse 2. Where Paul writes, through Him we have also obtained access by faith into this grace in which we stand. The word access means to enter the presence of a king. It speaks of the right to enter the inner chambers and speak with the king face to face. Access is a privilege given only to the king's family, close friends, and associates. Paul is saying that through Jesus Christ, we may now enter the very presence of God. Consider how revolutionary this truth is and was, especially for his Jewish readers. They were accustomed to a system that kept a respectful distance between God and man. The Gentiles were restricted to the outer court of the temples, a court called the Court of Gentiles. If a Gentile went beyond that court, he could be put to death. Next was the Court of Women that was for Jewish female worshipers. And then came the Court of Israel. That was for Jewish men. And inside that was the court of priests, where the altar of sacrifice was. And finally, inside the temple proper, there was the holy place, where only the priest could minister. And behind that was a holy of holies, separated by a thick curtain. Entrance into the holy of holies was restricted to the high priest, and that only once a year on the Day of Atonement. So the message was loud and clear. Keep your distance. But here, Paul is saying that we all now have access to God through him, that is, Jesus Christ. Everything God has for us comes through Jesus Christ. Jesus himself said that no one comes to the Father except through me. But when we come through Jesus, we are admitted into the very presence of God. Not the outer courts, not into some drab waiting room, but we are admitted into the very throne room of heaven. But also notice that access is based on grace that in which we stand. Our standing before God is based entirely on grace. We stand in God's presence as those who have a right to be there, not because of anything we have done, but because of his grace that is poured out on us. We stand in grace, not on the basis of our works, not on what we have done, but only on the merit of Jesus Christ. Grace gives us hope that one day the gates of heaven will swing open for us. As one writer put it, when you stand on grace, you're not standing on slippery ground, but on solid rock. No ground is as solid as the grace of God. Because of God's love and grace, we have the right to enter God's presence at any time. As God's children, we have the right to speak to God anytime we want. He's our Father. We are his children. And he loves to hear from us. Hebrews 4:16 speaks of coming boldly to the throne of grace. That word boldly literally means freedom of speech. God invites us to say whatever is on our mind. John Newton, the writer of Amazing Grace, wrote, "Thou art coming to a king. Large petitions with thee bring, for his grace and power are such, none can ever ask too much." Access to God is the second great benefit of justification by faith. The third is found at the end of verse 2. And we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. That word hope can be misleading because in common usage, hope means maybe it will happen and maybe it won't. Such as, I hope there will still be some leftover chocolate cake when I get home. But the biblical concept of hope is much different. It means a confident expectation that something will happen because God has said it would happen. Biblical hope is not a hope so, but a know so. The third great blessing from our justification is the confident expectation of the hope of glory. In his paraphrase, J.B. Phillips translates hope as the happy certainty of the glory of God. So what is this glory? It is what we fall short of. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. It is what Adam and Eve had in the Garden of Eden. It is the shining resident radiance of God's presence. It is what we will be like when we see Jesus face to face. At the end of 1 John 3:2, John writes, we will be like him because we will see him face to face. It is what we were meant to be. It is what we want more than anything in the world. Glory is also another word for heaven. In short, the hope of glory is a confident expectation that one day God will fulfill his promises to us. The hope of glory is the assurance that when you die, you are going to heaven. It is that simple. You either have it, you have that hope, or you don't. But can anyone be sure of heaven? Can our heavenly hope be a no-so hope? Yes. We can be that sure if our faith in God, it is our faith in God and his grace in which we stand. In 1 John 5:13, John says, I write these things that you may know that you have eternal life. And how can we know that? Because John tells us in one verse earlier, whoever has the Son has life. Do you have the happy certainty that heaven is your eventual destination? But before anyone thinks that the Christian life is only pie in the sky by and by, Paul quickly adds a surprising development in verse 3. Not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings. Sufferings. Other translations render that word as tribulations, hardships, afflictions, problems, troubles, trials. Do you get the picture? The bright lights of the distant heavenly future cannot cancel the dark realities of the present. What difference does knowing Christ make when my life has fallen apart, though? Does faith in Jesus make a difference when your marriage is on the rocks? When the cancer came back? When your children are in trouble, your company lays you off, your parents get a divorce, your daughter decides to have an abortion? When life tumbles in, what then? Does Jesus make a difference when the going is tough? Paul's answer is not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings. Now, someone might think that Paul has lost his mind. Rejoice in suffering? That's absurd. Nobody rejoices in problems. But that is what Paul said. We can understand that, though, when we read the rest. That's just the first half of verse 3. Let's look at the rest of 3 through verse 5. Knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. The most important word in this verse is knowing. We rejoice knowing. There are so many things we don't know. We don't know why cancer hits one person and not another. We don't know why the brakes failed. We don't know why the money didn't come in. We don't know why our child struggles. But when another excels, we don't know why the fire destroyed this block but not the next. So many things we don't know. In fact, there is so much more that we don't know than we know. But we do know this. All things work together for good. That's Romans 8:28. How do we know that all things work together? Well, one part of the answer is in Romans 3 and 4. Let me read that again. Knowing that our sufferings produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. The sufferings of life work together for good because they promote our spiritual growth. That's a radical thought, I know. For most of us, trials are merely something to be endured. We grit our teeth. We grin and bear it, if we grin at all. But Paul says, no, we rejoice in the hard times because we know that God is working in the hard times to produce something beautiful in us. The word suffering or affliction builds the picture of to press down. Suffering is that which presses down on us. It happens to all of us. No one is exempt from difficulty. No one gets a free pass. The message is simple. Suffering is a believer's servant, not his master. Not only do trials not overthrow or negate the blessings of God, they themselves lead into the blessings of God. The hard times of life are sent or allowed by God to produce something good in us. This is important to understand. God is not in the business of making everything easy for you and me. Believers are not exempt from life's challenges. That is a false hope. That is the false hope peddlers of the health and wealth gospel. They teach that God wants you to be healthy and filthy rich. Salvation is free, but the road to heaven is mostly uphill. Thankfully, though, we have God and each other to carry us along the way. Now, don't misunderstand what Paul is saying. We don't rejoice in the fact of our suffering. That would be odd and pathological. Suffering, by definition, is distasteful. It produces pain, and pain hurts. But pain can also help. We've all heard, no pain, no gain. So we rejoice in what we gain from our suffering. And what we gain in the end far outweighs the pain that we go through. 2 Corinthians 4:17 says, "For light and momentarily troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all." The things God accomplishes through suffering cannot be accomplished any other way. That is the reason we rejoice in suffering. So, what can affliction produce? Paul says that suffering produces endurance or perseverance. These are things that can't be developed or demonstrated without having to go through them. Endurance, then, produces proven character. This word was sometimes used of silver that has been passed through the fire so that all the dross, the impurities, were removed. The pure silver that was left was said to be the real thing. It was proven. Job 23 speaks to this point. "Yet he," God, "knows the way I have taken. When he has tested me, I will emerge as pure gold. Ray Stedman said, God is in the process of making veterans. He delights in taking raw, untested rookies and putting them in the crucible. When they come out, they aren't raw or untested, and they aren't rookies anymore. They're veterans, men and women of proven character. The final result is hope. As suffering does its work, we develop perseverance, then tested character, and finally, hope. The confident expectation that we will not be disappointed. What we discover in the darkness is that God is there to sustain us, and that gives us hope to keep on going. And here's the wonderful thing. As we cooperate with God, he completes his work in us, and we become kinder, gentler, more compassionate, less irritable, wiser, and more trustworthy. It's the process. We look back and we say, it wasn't me who did it, but it was God's doing. God keeps his promises. And we wouldn't have seen or known it without the trials of life. The path is hard, but the end result is that we become better people, refined, purified, tested, and yes, strengthened by the things we have suffered. Best of all, we discover that our sufferings have an eternal reward that outweighs them all. Hope does not disappoint, not in this life nor in the life to come. Nothing is wasted in a believer's life. Our worst trials are down payments on something wonderful to come. One more thing, Romans 5:5 again. The hope does not disappoint us because God has poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit whom he has given us. Those who know Jesus experience the love of God being poured into their lives. So many people make so many dumb choices because they're looking for love in all the wrong places. There's only one place where we can find perfect love, unconditional love. Love that sees us as we really are and accepts us anyway. That kind of love comes from God. One of the songs that I learned at camp years and years ago was the song Peace Like a River. Some of you have heard the words. I've got peace like a river. I've got joy like a fountain. I've got love like an ocean in my soul. The truth is, we find all we need in God and from God. So if you want peace like a river, then turn to Jesus. If you want joy like a fountain, then turn to Jesus. If you want love like an ocean, then turn to Jesus. The most sought after things in life are found in Jesus. Peace, joy, and love. Our greatest need is to know Jesus, to receive justification through him, which results in peace with God, access to God with his grace that leads to hope. Let's put our faith and trust in Jesus and experience all we need from him. The blessings of justification. In a moment, we're going to sing that beautiful hymn, My Hope is Built on Nothing Less. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ, the solid rock, I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. Make sure you are standing on the solid rock, Jesus Christ. Because the blessings of God, of his grace, come from Jesus and no other. the blessings of justification, being in a right standing with God, come through Jesus. Let's stand and sing, "My hope is built on nothing less." Where are you searching to have your needs met? The world offers us a lot of temporary stuff, but permanent, eternity, hope, love, joy, peace, they come from one source and one source only, Jesus Christ and His righteousness. Let's pray. Father God, we thank You for this opportunity that we have to hear from Your word. Father, we are grateful for the new lives You've given us, the love, the joy, the peace, the hope that we have in Jesus Christ. But Father, we understand that hope is not just for us, but is for us to share with others. Father, as we leave here today, help us to take what You've done in our lives into the love and the joy and the peace that You've poured into us. And help us to pour that into people's lives so they can see that the real source for what they want and need comes from You and You alone. Father, we thank You. In Your Son's holy and precious name we pray. Amen.